So Bjorn has just recently started last year at the Royal College of Art in London, and it's my great pleasure to introduce him for his presentation on immersive design engineering. So thank you, Bjorn.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Andrew. Yeah, it's my pleasure to give, I think it's the second last talk, yeah? I think so, yeah. So welcome to my presentation. Today I will not, it's not really something like a virtual reality facility talk, so it's more a little bit more on a global topic, immersive design engineering. So basically the idea is design engineering, so you can study it at a number of universities in the world. But I'm now affiliated to a program which is called Innovation Design Engineering, and this is where I'm coming from now. Basically, this is a program which is shared between the Royal College of Art and Imperial College. The very amazing thing, so as you just heard from Andrew, I just started last year, but the amazing thing is it has a 40 years history, so it's really a long-going program. It first started to be called Industrial Design Engineering, then it changed something like 10 years ago to Innovation Design Engineering, and at the moment, so we have, it's a two-year master program. The Royal College of Art has only postgraduate students there, so you can study their master and PhD. Imperial College, everybody of you knows the Imperial College, you have, of course, a whole range. And basically, 50 and 50% between these two programs are shared. So our students are permanently running in between these two buildings. So this is the Darwin building. We are currently not located in the Darwin building, but in the Stevens building, which you see on the right corner of it. We just moved in the beginning of this year to this building. And on the right side, you see the Dyson School of Design Engineering. This is from Imperial College. So we are always changing between these two locations. So we are talking about design engineering. I don't want to give here now a precise definition of design engineering, as it's also not so easy possible, because it's a very interdisciplinary field. But basically, I found a very nice article about how design engineers spend their time. So it's not so old, so it's from 2012, and it was looking at roughly 90 participants. And you can see that these are just a few numbers, so it's really interesting if you're from this field. So what is your average time, what you spend doing your working days? So 62% is technical work, for example, but 40% is social work, which really shows, so an engineer is, of course, not somebody who's just sitting all the time in front of his computer, so he always has to collaborate with different persons and communicate about the next steps to do. Then just a few things I took out here, 9% of the time, which is already a lot in this field, is creating geometry, so you have to work with spatial objects. 50% nearly is on the computer, which is also very interesting. And then there's a category, so on computer software. So which kind of computer software they were asked, are they using most of the time? 12% was the top number two, which was CAD, so computer-aided design. So also, again, working with spatial models. So what do you think is number one? It's something different. I think all of us know the problem. Number one is email. The same applies to my job, and I think also to all of your jobs. So again, communication, but then via digital media, of course. So, but the interesting takeaway here is, if you are a design engineer, the main software which most people use is CAD, which means you have to deal with spatial objects. So, and this is why it's very interesting to look into immersive technologies, because this is, of course, very important to work with spatial three-dimensional structures and also then time-based structures. So what is the special thing about our program? It's a lot also about studio work. So my field, my background is computer science, so my bachelor was in media informatics and design. So then my PhD is in bioinformatics, and then I transferred a little bit now back to design again. It's quite exciting. It's quite different from what normally people expect from design. So it's not so much only about beautiful visualization and art. So it's a lot looking into the process, how to work with different people. It's very interdisciplinary, like you can see it here, the studio work. So this was from a global a program called Go Global. So this is happening once a year. Then for 3 weeks in our program, the students are somewhere else in the world. This time they will be indeed in Japan. So here a lot it's about ideation, come up with new ideas. So this is virtual reality, of course, at the RCA, which is a quite small, as I said, postgraduate college, but of course virtual reality is a big topic there. You see there Paul Anderson, who is at the moment the dean from the School of Design, where I'm working at now. He has had a number of virtual reality related and also stereoscopy related projects running. And so this was in his previous time at Glasgow School of Art, but of course there are also new projects running. You see downstairs there, that is from the School of Architecture, so they have a number of projects using the Vive, using the Oculus Rift, and also other display technologies. So I want this paper, when it will be finished, will be a review of different technologies which are looking into immersive visualization technologies and navigation exploration technologies you can take into account. But basically, I want to give you a short overview of work I was doing before and work some of my of our previous students were doing. So this is something some of you have seen before. This was work I was doing before 2016 at Monash University. And basically what you are seeing, this is the Cave 2. So you heard Kurt yesterday giving a very nice talk about this. So Monash was, I don't know, it was one of the first five, I think, locations where this Cave 2 was installed. Kurt, if you're in the audience, please correct me if I'm wrong. Yeah. And so basically I had the pleasure, I was working for 1 year at Monash University in Melbourne, and I had the pleasure to work with this project. And what I did there was I connected the Z-Space, which most of you also will know. So this is a very excellent 3D display, which has head tracking and interaction with a 3D pen. I used this device and, yeah, thanks. I used this device to navigate inside this cave too. So basically, I used the pen, and with the pen, you could click on different positions, and the camera of the Cave 2 was moving then towards this. So this is the technology behind it. So this was the software was from my Cell Microcosmos project, which is a long-running project, which was based on Java 3D. This was running on the Z-Space, and on the Monash University Cave 2, basically, was an OmegaLib C++ OpenGL technology running. So this was a technology. It was, of course, semi-immersive, but the nice thing is both was passive, passive immersion into it. And that worked very good because you could directly change between the three-dimensional visualization of the Z-space and the three-dimensional visualization of the Cave 2 with full stereoscopy. So it was polarized stereoscopic visualization. So this was this paper. The idea behind this is, so you had this Cave 2, which is consisting of 80 monitors, and it was hooked up with a direct connection from the Z-space to a server computer, which was connected to a number of nodes. And in this way, then directly the visualization was transferred. And the idea what you can do now is you have one navigator in the center of it, and around it, you have a number of people observing it. So basically, this is one approach how you could tackle the problem which Kurt yesterday mentioned. So the problem that also when I came into the Cave 2 the first time, the problem was there was always one guy who was navigating, and also he was the one the perspective was optimized for. So I removed this optimization. And the idea was that really everybody in the room has the same perspective into the virtual space, and you have only a navigator, and the navigator is using the Z-space to do the navigation into this, to jump from one point to the next one. So this is, of course, the problem is that's a quite expensive approach, which a university like Monash can afford. So they have a large team working behind this, but then I moved to Konstanz University. We had, of course, not this budget. What I did there with my colleagues was we set up a display consisting of the six different OLED displays. So you see it's again polarized stereoscopic 3D, so you could also combine it again with a Z-space. The technology we used this time was WebGL. So and the idea behind this was, these are six different browser windows, and these six different WebGL based browser windows are synchronized. So we have, I think, three papers on this, we wrote on this at this time. And basically, you could observe how a bird behaves. You could observe the different bird perspectives. And this is all based on real data, real life data. Not live data in the sense that it's directly transferred, but this data is coming from GPS sensors. So it was transferred then to our program. And this is visualized in Cesium. So if you know, maybe you heard of Cesium, the nice thing of Cesium is in comparison to Google Maps, you have access to the full source code and you can optimize it for your purposes. And also, like you see here with this nice OLED screens, use it for 3D navigation and visualization. So what I did was, in the paper we showed the last time, is we did an analysis, so based on different locations. So just as you see in the next image, you will see, so we have a top row, which will be verified, and then we have the single monitor view. If we look to the, there's a paper out there also on this. So this is basically the outcome of this. So when we showed this to a number of people, I think this were 16 people where we did the evaluation with, basically, we try to find out, does it really make sense? Is this a multi-view environment so that a number of people can sit in the room and use it? And it's especially important because we wanted that our colleagues from the Max Planck Institute in Konstanz on animal behavior can work with this setup. And you see now, so this red locations, there are more or less no-go locations where it's really, where the 3D effect is quite annoying to observe. Then we have this neutral ones, the yellow ones, where you have indeed this effect that there are some negative monitors, which means that the accommodation is not really working fine on these monitors. But then we have seven positive ones, which basically means you have no rows, which are negative, as well as no monitors, so single monitors, which are negative. So this means basically we have this seven locations, which are working quite nicely. So this is only very rough. Please look at the paper if you have more questions, or ask me later on this topic. So now I want to come to a very nice topic, which was started before I come to the Royal College of Art. This is a student from our program called Ned Martins. So, and he started a very nice project during his master time. So this was his first sketches, and I'll show you this so that you have a little bit an idea how our program works. So this is just the ideation again. So he started to make some first sketches, and he wanted to have a nice augmented reality navigation device. So these were the first sketches. This was the first prototype. So it's quite interesting. We have a number of people there who start this program without having an idea about programming, and after they finish, they are quite good in programming. So here you see the first prototype. So it's just, as you can see, a very simple one. Then he started already on the right side to have some first 3D printing involved. And this was here, the video, which was part of his master thesis. And if you look to the ring he's using now, you will see it's different from the final product, which I'll show you in the next video. I will not show the whole video, we don't have enough time for that, but just that you get the idea. So this was more to generate the vision, what he wanted to do with this ring. So he basically wants to use it to navigate into the real world, to build up kind of different virtual environments, but then in the park, and then use it also, of course, also for navigation. So again, so that's a mock-up. It does not work like this, as you can imagine, but this was his initial prototype and what he wanted the prototype to look like. So and now we come to the version which was the developer edition, which was announced in 2019. So basically, it has a number of sensors, like a motion sensor. It is using the Apple AR kit number 2. I know there's already the number 3 also. I think they are working on this, that it also will work with version number 3 from Apple AR kit. So basically, the idea is you have, I have here one of these developer devices with me. Some of you might have seen it in the demo session. So basically, you can connect it to a smartphone with Bluetooth, and it makes use of the smartphone's image recognition software and combines it with the sensors here to have a very nice 3D navigation. This is now the actual video, and also this I will not play in full, but that you have an idea. So the software they will be using, showing first, that's indeed the software which is already working now. It's still, of course, so it was an early prototype from last year. But what you see there, you can actually do. What you basically in the beginning have to do, you have to scan your environment, you have to register the 3D space around you, and then from there you can start and place objects. The important thing is if you use this AR kit, you need a very bright room. So I had yesterday a little bit problems because I think on one hand, he did not like so much the pattern of the carpet. And on the other hand, it was not very bright there. But still it worked quite good. Yeah. The interesting thing comes now. So that's still the app I showed yesterday. And the other thing you can see now on the left side, they were using it also with a special software to change the lighting inside a room. And so they can point directly at a light source, and the light source is changing then the brightness. Yeah, I come to the conclusions. So especially the talks which you saw yesterday and today, so the technology is there. So we have to make use of it. Of course, it's not all commercially already available, so there are a lot of impressive devices. So I don't I hope that most of you have seen this Vario headset. So that's already available now. I think that that Bernard is at the moment doing another demo session, but so that's quite impressive. It comes with a price tag, of course, but. So you have really a very good resolution. Then Kurt yesterday talked about the future of caves. So there's a lot in there also. And I think both have still their, so they are for both their application cases, also for the zSpace application cases, it always depends on what you want to do and in which direction you want to go. And I think the really great challenges now, we have so much nice technology, which is working quite well, but the applications are really, many, many good applications are still missing. So there's so much possibility and potential to do, especially in terms of engineering, which can be achieved in the future, like this device, so improve navigation, improve the visualization. As we heard today, visualization is maybe not the most important thing anymore because you actually have already photorealistic visualization. But to bring it all together in a nice and intuitive way, that's of course a big challenge. And this is also something we will talk about more in the paper then. So please watch out for the proceedings paper. I come quickly to the acknowledgements. These were some of the people I was working in the past together with. Thanks go out, of course, also to NET. Then I got some funding to go here from our internal research funding grant. And most importantly, so I have here a message from LISO, basically. So if you're interested in LISO, so it's normally $200, and if you're interested in this, so you have something like one month's time, you get 30% off. So you can, I tried it yesterday, so you can just, if you go to liso.cc, then you can check out. And during the checkout, you have put there the stereoscopic, and then the 30% come directly off. But if you have more questions, I can put you directly in contact with the developer. So he's, of course, keen to get feedback or get other people interested in this. And for us, it's so, yeah. I will not get money out of that, but I'm really interested because I like the technology just to drive this forward and get you in contact with him. Yeah, that's from my side. Thanks a lot for your attention.